The story of Joseph is a very appealing story. It has even been made into a popular movie, which is called The Prince of Egypt. Joseph was promoted to foreman over the others and dressed in a way that indicated he did not have to do manual labor. Because Joseph was not the eldest son, such preference caused considerable resentment. Joseph is the fourth generation, Abraham's great-grandson, and, once again, he is not the eldest. There is a clear pattern here. The natural heir is not blessed. God chooses who receives his grace. It has traditionally been one of the younger sons. Joseph was one of Jacob's 12 sons and his father's favorite, according to the Bible. Joseph's father gave him a colored robe when he was 17 years old. Genesis chapter 37, verses 1 through 3. And Jacob dwelt in the land wherein his father was a stranger, in the land of Canaan. These are the generations of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brethren, and the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and with the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. Now Israel loved Joseph more than all his children, because he was the son of his old age, and he made him a coat of many colors. As if that wasn't enough, Joseph had a special gift. God revealed to him what would happen in the future through dreams. Joseph was Jacob and Rachel's son. They lived in Haran at the time of his birth in the house of his grandfather Laban. Jacob and his 12 sons settled in Canaan, where their father Isaac, Abraham's son, had previously resided. Jacob loved his son Joseph the most of all of them, because he was the son of his old age and had a pure and innocent soul. But seeing that their father loved him more than all of them, his brothers despised him. One day, while he was in the field with his brothers, forming sheaves with the hay, Joseph dreamed that his sheaf would get up and stand upright, and his brothers' sheaves would surround her and bow down before her. Genesis chapter 37, verses 5 through 10. Joseph had a dream, and when he told it to his brothers, they hated him all the more. He said to them, "Listen to this dream I had. We were binding sheaves of grain out in the field when suddenly my sheaf rose and stood upright, while your sheaves gathered around mine and bowed down to it." His brothers said to him, "Do you intend to reign over us? Will you actually rule us?" And they hated him all the more because of his dream and what he had said. Then he had another dream, and he told it to his brothers. "Listen," he said, "I had another dream, and this time the sun and moon and 11 stars were bowing down to me." When he told his father as well as his brothers, his father rebuked him and said, "What is this dream you had? Will your mother and I and your brothers actually come and bow down to the ground before you?" Genesis chapter 37, verses 11 through 13. And his brethren envied him, but his father observed the saying. And his brethren went to feed their father's flock in Shechem. And Israel said unto Joseph, "Do not thy brethren feed the flock in Shechem? Come, and I will send thee unto them." And he said to him, "Here I am." Then Joseph set out to find his brothers. When they saw him arrive, they decided it was time to get rid of him. But terrified by what his brothers intended to do, Reuben exclaimed, "No, don't murder him. We must not get his blood on our hands. Throw him into the well in the desert and don't touch him." They did exactly that, but first they removed his tunic in order to show it to his father later and inform him that Joseph had died. Genesis chapter 37, verses 25 through 28. And they sat down to eat bread, and they lifted up their eyes and looked, and behold, a company of Ishmaelites came from Gilead with their camels bearing spicery and balm and myrrh, going to carry it down to Egypt. And Judah said unto his brethren, "What profit is it if we slay our brother and conceal his blood? Come, and let us sell him to the Ishmaelites, and let not our hand be upon him, for he is our brother and our flesh." And his brethren were content. Then there passed by Midianites, merchantmen, and they drew and lifted up Joseph out of the pit, and sold Joseph to the Ishmaelites for 20 pieces of silver, and they brought Joseph into Egypt. Joseph was forced to accompany the caravan of merchants on their way to Egypt. He went the entire journey with remorse, unable to understand why his brothers had sold him. Genesis 39 is a wonderful example of sexual purity. Potiphar, a powerful and prosperous man, bought Joseph from the Ishmaelites. Pharaoh's servant was Potiphar. He appears to be the owner of a large and profitable ranch. Potiphar gradually realized that God's hand was on Joseph. Everything he touched seemed to turn to gold. Potiphar soon delegated authority over everything to Joseph. Potiphar's only decisions concerned what he would eat for dinner. Joseph did not just have the great character, he also had a skill in executive leadership. A leader as great as Potiphar trusted him enough to give him his responsibilities. Then Potiphar's wife took notice of Joseph. She attempted to seduce him in a variety of ways, but Joseph was determined to avoid her. Finally, she managed to trap Joseph in the house alone one day, where she attempted to seduce him once more. He felt compelled to flee, leaving his outer garment in her grasp. Then she accused Joseph of assaulting her, and her husband Potiphar had Joseph imprisoned. Years had passed since Joseph's arrival in Egypt, and the palace was in disarray. Pharaoh had two dreams that terrified him, and none of his advisors could explain them to him. Potiphar then told him about the young Hebrew who lived in his house and his extraordinary abilities in dream interpretation. Genesis chapter 41, verses 14 through 24. Pharaoh sent for Joseph at once, and he was quickly brought from the prison. After he shaved and changed his clothes, he went in and stood before Pharaoh. Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, "I had a dream last night, and no one here can tell me what it means. But I have heard that when you hear about a dream, you can interpret it." "It is beyond my power to do this," Joseph replied. "But God can tell you what it means and set you at ease." So Pharaoh told Joseph his dream. "In my dream," he said, "I was standing on the bank of the Nile River, and I saw seven fat, healthy cows come up out of the river and begin grazing in the marsh grass. But then I saw seven sick-looking cows, scrawny and thin, come up after them. I've never seen such sorry-looking animals in all the land of Egypt. These thin, scrawny cows ate the seven fat cows. But afterward, you wouldn't have known it, for they were still as thin and scrawny as before. Then I woke up. In my dream, I also saw seven heads of grain, full and beautiful, growing on a single stalk. Then seven more heads of grain appeared, but these were blighted, shriveled, and withered by the east wind. And the shriveled heads swallowed the seven healthy heads. I told these dreams to the magicians, but no one could tell me what they mean." Right then and there, Joseph responded to Pharaoh, "Your two dreams are merged into one. The seven fat cows and seven full ears represent 7 years of prosperity and abundance for Egypt. However, they will be followed by the seven skinny cows and the 7 ears of corn. Another 7 years of drought, but in these years of famine and scarcity, they will devastate Egypt's lands. And here's what you need to do. Find a wise man and place him in charge of Egypt's lands, in charge of guarding the crops in years of abundance, and assuring that your people have enough to eat in years of scarcity." Pharaoh was impressed by Joseph's words and decided to appoint him as administrator of his lands and crops. As a result, after Pharaoh, a Hebrew slave became the most powerful man in Egypt. Joseph the Hebrew, son of Jacob, was appointed administrator of all the lands of Egypt because he knew how to interpret Pharaoh's dreams, which predicted 7 years of abundant harvests for Egypt, followed by 7 years of scarcity. He owed obedience only to Pharaoh, while everyone else was to obey him. After 7 years of abundance, the land produced as much wheat as the sand of the sea, so much so that counting had to be stopped because it could not be counted. The granaries of all Egyptian cities and peoples were overflowing. Until one day, the land stopped producing and there were no crops left. As Joseph had predicted, the seven lean years came to pass. And there was a famine in all the lands except Egypt, because their barns were full. So Joseph ordered that the grain be distributed little by little among the families, so that no one went hungry. Famine was spreading outside of Egypt, and people came from all over to buy the wheat stored in Egypt's granaries. Also in Canaan, where Jacob and his family lived, the effects of the scarcity became apparent, prompting Jacob to instruct his sons to go down there and buy food. It was as Prime Minister of Egypt that Joseph welcomed the family. He not only forgave his brothers' offenses, but provided them with all their livelihood. He knew how to interpret the adversities he had gone through. In the face of the perplexity of his brothers, he declared to them, "God has sent me before your face to preserve your succession in the earth and to keep you alive for a great deliverance." Genesis chapter 45, verse 7. Jacob settles with his relatives in the land of Goshen after meeting his old father, where he supports them. And it was there, away from the influence of the Canaanites and Egyptians, that the Hebrews could grow into a great and powerful nation. Exodus chapter 1, verses 6 through 7. And Joseph died, and all his brethren, and all that generation. And the children of Israel were fruitful, and increased abundantly, and multiplied, and waxed exceeding mighty, and the land was filled with them. Isaiah chapter 64, verse 4. For since the beginning of time, no one is heard, no one is seen, no one has seen a God other than you, who works for him, who waits for him. Genesis chapter 39, verses 6 and 7. And he felt all that he had in Joseph's hand, and he knew not aught he had, save the bread which he did eat. And Joseph was a goodly person and well favored. And it came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast her eyes upon Joseph, and she said, "Lie with me." According to the Bible, Joseph was not only an attractive man, Genesis chapter 39, verse 6, but he was also very intelligent. After all, Potiphar hands over everything he owns to him. And it came to pass after these things that his master's wife set her eyes upon Joseph and said to him, "Lie with me." When he said no to the woman, he didn't stay there, tempted to demonstrate his inner strength. He ran. She grabbed him so tightly that his clothes were left behind. Then she grabbed his cloak and said, "Lie with me." But he fled, leaving the cloak in her grasp and escaping outside. This woman's desire had gone insane, driving her to disrespect her home and husband. Joseph, for his part, did not forget what his parents had taught him. He was no longer present, but his teachings remained strong in his heart. As he was taught about God, he memorized the words. He could have taken advantage of the opportunity that was presented to him, but he chose to be obedient to God. He chose to suffer for the sake of the uncommitted in order to deny his faith and respect for his servant Potiphar. Adversity enters our lives to test us, to teach us a different path than the one we are accustomed to taking. Then, like an earthquake, everything starts to shake, but we can't stop walking. We learn from adversity that our gifts and talents should not be kept in a drawer and used whenever we want, but he must make himself available to God, because it is the way out of the difficulties that we face. When we see adversity as an opportunity to overcome obstacles, we see far beyond the impossible. That's exactly how Joseph was. He fell when he arrived at the prison, as who wouldn't? But he didn't let his emotions get the best of him. Instead, he saw it as an opportunity to convey his message to the king. He not only used his gift to interpret his cellmate's dreams, but he also told the butler not to forget him, that is, to say that I am here, that I am still alive and ready to return. He had to wait 2 years because the plans are ours and the execution is God's. Another interesting fact in Joseph's life is that he could have let himself be carried away by the hatred of his brothers and prostrate himself, becoming sick with bitterness and sadness. Instead, the jailer saw in Joseph his lack of guilt, honesty, and trust beyond usual standards to be called to work. Instead, showed service, zeal for the tasks, and gained confidence. He didn't just stand there in prison waiting for time to pass. He used his gift of dream interpretation once more. God sees in Joseph a mature man who loved him even in times of struggle and adversity, and who did not allow bitterness of spirit to dominate him. Even after becoming governor, he did not become arrogant. He was faithful in both prison and the palace, and everything he touched prospered. The reward for being faithful and obedient and having a heart cleansed of all the flaming feelings of contention, God restores to you your family, your beloved father. Joseph's desire for vengeance was most likely triggered when he saw his brothers. He cried like a child when he showed his brothers who he was. God compensated his tears, which he collected and transformed into joy and a smile. Are you also dealing with adversity? I can imagine how painful it is. But don't close your eyes to what good can come from this time. There may be an opportunity for you to develop, demonstrate your abilities, and gain wisdom. Let us be aware of what God in Christ Jesus is teaching us so that we do not miss out on any opportunities that arise along the way.